right, well, we're back again with another interview at Industry Giants 2018. We're here with Richard Lyons, is correct, right?
Yep.
Fantastic. Concept artist at Naughty Dog. Right.
Correct.
And you're still currently there, still working on all kinds of awesome stuff.
Yep, been there for about 4.5 years now. Yeah.
And I think you're Australian.
Correct.
I have a small guess.
Melbourne, Australia.
There you go. And so, where do you live here in...
Or? Yeah, I live in Los Angeles in Culver City.
Is that where the main studio is at as well?
It's in Santa Monica, so it's very close by.
I got you. Yeah. So you just commute, I guess? That's where that...
Yeah, cool. Yeah, it's very close by, but traffic in LA is
kind of a,
bloody awful.
Yeah, we had a conversation about that with another guy that lives out there, so yeah, I can only imagine. So that's... You have fun with that. Well, cool. So what are you presenting here today? Or have you already presented?
I presented already. Okay. Basically, I was just running people through the character pipeline, two character pipelines. One that I worked at an older studio, THQ Blue Tongue in Melbourne, and the pipeline we employed there and how art versus pipeline becomes a little bit of an issue. Mm-hmm. And then also the pipeline we used on Uncharted, The Lost Legacy. And hopefully the students, for the most part, their big takeaway is how drawing pictures is only a really small part of what a concept artist does. Mm-hmm. Especially a studio like Naughty Dog, where you sort of end up having to follow that baby all the way down the pipeline. So there's a lot of notes afterwards, there's a lot of costuming involved, a lot of scanning, sourcing actually real costumes and dressing up models and or in the case of the character that I was talking about today, actually being the model yourself. So
So who'd you model or as?
I was the body of Asav, who's the villain in The Lost Legacy. I'm actually the body of heaps of characters.
That's awesome.
The character team in general, you'll see their bodies all the way through all of our games.
That's
so our most recent trailer for The Last of Us, most recent one, or the one previous. The one where Ellie's playing guitar.
Yeah, yeah. Love that one.
Awesome trailer.
Yeah,
so good. Joel's feet walking through the hallway.
Yeah.
There's a dead body.
Yeah.
The first one on the left. That's me.
Nice.
The second dead body is another character concept artist, Alex. And the third one is another character concept, environment concept artist, Aaron. And he's the one face down on the ground.
That is hilarious. Like, I'm all over that. So do you do body scans for that? Or like, how do you have someone just model you as reference? Or for
the we use scanning. So we'll actually use costumers. And that's what I was talking about our pipeline today. So once we're finished our character concepts, the drawing side and presenting all our photo reference, which we do because our games are based heavily in reality, so we're sourcing real life things.
Gotcha.
Why reinvent a pair of jeans when here's a pair of jeans?
Yeah.
So once that's approved, we'll actually send our stuff out to a costumer, and we've got an amazing costumer, Sarah, and she'll bring back the outfits that we're after, and maybe something a little bit different each side.
Yeah.
Then we source models and actors, and we'll dress those people up. Then we scan them.
Nice.
Goes into the game, and then we just make sure we're getting all those little notes and details in afterwards.
That's super cool. So you actually get to basically play dress up with actual people and stuff like that, just for fun. So,
yeah,
it's not for fun, but you know what I mean. It is fun.
It is. It's a lot of fun, but it's a different animal from working on games that are stylized, where you're doing a lot of painting and then that's the approval, then you're making those notes afterwards. For us, it's easier, especially in a city like LA, it's easy to just tell people that you're a costumer or a costume designer.
Okay.
And then people understand if they're anything involved with film, they understand that that's what you're doing. You're making costumes for a living, you're designing costumes, which for the most part, we're employing a pipeline that's more similar to film right up until the point that it's scanned into 3D.
Gotcha. Okay. It makes total sense. That's super cool. So, have you worked on any film projects before? Or do you just enjoy doing game stuff mostly? I mean, obviously, you're at Naughty Dog, so.
I really enjoy the game stuff. The game stuff is where the juice is for me. But I've worked on a couple of TV projects back in the day. There's a worked on a few pictures for an amazing director, Greg McLean, back in Australia. No, but for the most part, it's all been video games.
Gotcha. Yeah. Well, I guess in working on The Last of Us, since it is based in like actual reality, I'm assuming it might be more important that the attention to detail, because it is kind of post-apocalyptic, obviously, but it's people know what lamps look like. It's not some crazy alien artifact type thing. Like, so you're really getting real life sources and stuff like that is super important. So
yeah, absolutely.
And I guess that's where Sarah comes in handy, where you're like, I need jeans, and does she just go out and give you like 12 different pairs that you would choose
from? Yeah, pretty much. I mean, it's we have designs. Our intention is to execute on what the creative director wants and the art director wants. and support that narrative or support that thematical beat.
Yeah.
How can we do that without distracting the audience or without breaking immersion? And certainly when it's set in what's very much a real place and a real world that people understand, that's a plant, that's a lamp, like you're saying, they're in a real house. All we really want to do is just make sure that that focus is where it's meant to be. So we're not going to distract you with reinventing some costume with 20 belts and some fine fantasy kind of stuff.
Exactly.
You know, it's cool fun to draw,
but
that's not going to make for a better, you know, a better project in the end. So,
well, like you said, breaking immersion, like that's, I mean, I play the games and I love them, and it's because the story is so driven and you're so focused on what's happening. Like, I don't remember any time where I was like, that's weird, that's out of place, or whatever. Like, so kudos to you on that one, I guess. So,
thank you. Whenever I see projects, all I can see is stuff that's out of place.
Really?
That I didn't have time to fix.
That's too, so, I do visual effects and CG.
That's
so, yeah, so, but your job is that other people don't notice that you notice it because you've been doing it for so long. But hopefully, if people don't notice it, it means you're doing your job well, basically. So hopefully, right? Well, that's the dream, anyways.
You have to be so scrupulous. You have to have that brain of just tearing stuff apart.
Yep, technical
to
detail.
get to that level, and then eventually someone says, "No, that's it."
Yeah, stop messing with it. Yeah,
you know, there's five things I didn't get to fix. So.
Well, and like we were just talking previously, you know, the date hasn't really been announced, and it's because you guys want to work on it a little bit more. So that's very important. That like actually, you guys, we need a little bit more time to get these details exactly how we want them, rather than just saying, "Nope, well, I guess that's it," and then putting it out though, right? So
yeah, I mean that's the idea. We don't know when it's gonna be done because we're not there yet.
Yeah, so, exactly. Once spend that time. Well, so you personally, do you prefer doing stuff based in reality, or do you like doing crazy conceptual stuff? If you had the choice, obviously.
I just think they're sort of different animals. I think if we were gonna do some crazy conceptual stuff, you know, I'd be interested in employing the same kind of techniques and subtlety that we are employing on Uncharted and The Last of Us as well. I think all of those things still hold true, and I see, at least for me as an audience, where they fall down in other, you know, like sci-fi films and other sci-fi games, is people get a little carried away, I think, with the designing the sort of individual elements and having fun as an individual. And then as a whole, immersion is often a problem.
Getting people
to be able to relate to the characters. Mm-hmm. I mean, we could always go back to these same films as reference points because people were sucked in straight away and they understood where they were, they understood the place, they understood the characters, even though it might have been fantastical. And that's why we always go back and reference like Alien, Aliens, Blade Runner.
Yeah.
Because you can see these things straight away. Relating to people. Alien's a great example. You know, you're in this sci-fi space, has those sort of slow camera shots around, computers are coming on, and you're like, oh, well, this is pretty, like, weird and amazing.
Yeah.
But then when the people get up and they start talking to each other in the banter, you understand exactly where everyone sits.
Yeah.
You got the blue-collar work guys, you got the sort of the middle management, and you got the intellectual snob, and it's sort of the, instantly they're established in a really nice way that's not patronizing to the audience. And also they're eating as well. They get up, they're hungry,
they're
tired, they're like, oh shit, when they wake up, whatever. And they're doing all this stuff that you can relate to.
Yeah, so when you design characters, then you kind of keep that in mind, because obviously that like those stereotypes or personalities, like that, I'm assuming that shows through in your character design. So
yeah, I mean, there's a way to do it with hopefully we're not too heavy-handed about it. And that was part of the talk that I give today about presenting your characters in a more cinematic fashion. Just because you can give your art director or your creative director just a little bit more information to choose those costumes, because mainly they're just looking at them in isolation, and there's a temptation to rely on stereotypes and tropes to achieve that. In this case, it was a villain. You know, does he need an eye patch?
Or a star,
you know, all these other kind of tropes that we go for.
Big beard.
Or are we just going to give him? You know, we're just going to give the audience a chance to like stew on this character and see this character doing evil things or behaving in an evil way.
Yeah.
There's so many other factors that come into it later on. You know, lighting, music. Mm-hmm. What I was showing was lighting and cinematic techniques to present that character. But
so do you get to see like the script or storyline beforehand? Like, so maybe you have a villain that you have to design for, but they want you, the person playing the game, to not realize that he's a villain until like later on or something. So obviously you don't want to rely on that. So it's like the twist. So do you know that's going to happen, or they're just like, oh, we just need this guy that's medium height, medium build, does this, and go make him look cool? Like, how does that work as far as concepting goes?
I think it's really nice at a studio, and I can only speak to Naughty Dog about this.
Sure.
I know other studios, it's a little bit more detached. I've worked at studios that have had like a lot of producers, a lot of buffers.
Mm-hmm.
So they might come to you with a very specific, hey, we want this creature and it's going to do this. And you're like, okay, cool. You draw it and then it's gone. And you'll see it in game months down the track.
Gotcha.
And you're like, okay, that's kind of what we talked about.
Just a little bit,
but you're not privy to the other conversations that happen after that. Mm-hmm. So you just leave it alone. And Naughty Dog, it's got a little bit more of a garage feel to it.
Mm-hmm.
We don't have producers per se. We have an amazing production team, but we don't have producers in that sense. So a lot of the information is disseminated to the whole team at really early stages. So they kind of pitch the idea of the whole story back to the studio,
mm-hmm.
and you'll be able to, you know, watch. In this case, it was, I think the last one was Neil Druckmann, mm-hmm. Creative director on this project, and he was talking through the whole scene. So it'd be scene by scene, like what's gonna happen in our game.
Gotcha, so it's almost like an animatic that you have to watch and kind of go back on it. So
we get on it a little bit earlier than that, I guess, being concept artists, there's a lot of pre-production stuff. And then there's also, we actually produce for, you know, Uncharted and the other games I've worked on so far, we'll produce the images for those animatics.
Gotcha.
Does that answer your question? So it's very important for everyone who's working on, let's say, this character,
mm-hmm.
they know this character, you know, is this type of person.
Yeah,
why would they dress in this? Mm-hmm. You know, are they vain? Are they materialistic?
Mm-hmm.
Are they functional? You know, have they been down on their knees in a muddy area?
Yeah.
You need to know that because then you need mud on the knees. You know
what I mean? Exactly.
So we need to work that stuff out. Have they been running? Do they put on weight? Have they lost weight?
Gotcha.
You know, so all that kind of stuff, really scrupulous. Yeah, then from one scene to the next, this guy's been kicked in the face. What does that look like later down the track?
So then would you design that? Say if they get hurt in one game, then
absolutely.
There's a sequel. Then you get to say, oh, his arm's gone now, so he's got a
fall. Oh, certainly something obvious like that. Yeah. But we'll get down to subtleties of, you know, and we've covered it again in today's talk, but Asav gets a wicked beating from two different people at the end of the game.
So it progresses and you get to actually, like, so you already know what he's going to look like.
Yeah,
obviously.
But those injuries will occur as you're playing the game.
Wow.
So we need to know where those impacts are happening. You know, is his head facing this way? Does blood drop this way? Then he turns his head that way. Then the blood's going to change direction this way. So we need to know all those things. So
would you say from like final concept drawing to in-game model, like, is it very accurate, or is there sometimes like the 3D artist has to, you know, change up a little bit to make things work, or is that just part of the process?
I think it's always got to be flexible.
Yeah.
It's fine and dandy to have things approved on concept,
mm-hmm.
But when things go into game, there's always going to be other things that are going to impact on that character.
Mm-hmm.
A great example is your NPC characters, mm-hmm. characters that you're sort of shooting or battling against. Often you design them in isolation. You try your best to understand what environments they're going to be in.
Yep.
And then later on, as that lighting finally comes in, and you know the art director might have switched the color palette of that area, all of a sudden those characters might be disappearing into the background.
Oh yeah, just washed out a little bit too much.
So
it's
like, well, hang on. So how do I get that character to pop?
You know, so
it's about, you know, how do you get those characters to group together? How do you get them to pop out as individuals? So you might have to tweak some color palettes. You might have to rework some things there.
So does the director come to you and say, hey, we're having this issue. We're like, say, a mob scene. These guys are kind of blending in too much. How would we adjust that? Or
sometimes the director, designers. We have an amazing team of designers, and for the most part, you know, they're the ones that pick up on these things. They're the ones that ask for these things in the first place.
Yeah.
And then they'll come back and go, hey, look, you know, we're trying to play this bit, and
mm-hmm.
this guy keeps killing me. I can't see where he's shooting from.
Gotcha, yeah.
I mean, for that example, but...
So the gameplay is a huge thing, because if you can't see the guy, obviously, it's going to be harder to actually do anything.
Yeah, we're making a game, so at the end of the day, you know, Naughty Dog, we're really good at telling stories. That's really what attracted me to the studio, but if it's not fun to play, then no one gives a shit about the story.
I mean, that's true, yeah.
Then let's just make a movie, you know, so.
Oh, yeah, right, there you go.
So there's a nice balance there. You've got narrative and gameplay and sort of shuffling and balancing the pacing between those and making sure that gameplay supports narrative and narrative supports gameplay.
Yeah.
It's a tricky thing.
Huge back and forth.
You know, but, you know, we've got a team of amazing people that seem to been pulling it off
for
years.
No, I mean, I love the film. I'm hooked. I can't wait for the next one. So, yeah. Or any of the games, Uncharted, Last of Us.
Hopefully we'll do it again.
Did you do Crash Bandicoot? No, that's a little... Actually, no, they did a remake of that one, didn't they? So I haven't played the remake yet, so...
We didn't do the actual remake, but it's awesome. I played it.
There you go. Well, so I got to wrap it up here pretty quickly, but I got caught up on all the new game stuff. So just really quickly, what is your background? Do you have education? Did you just self-taught?
I studied illustration. I wanted to be an illustrator. And then shortly after that, I fell into a job in Melbourne, Australia, working at a company just drawing pictures. Mm-hmm. And it's like, it turns out it's called concept art.
I didn't know this
job existed.
Nice.
So I kind of went about it ass backwards. Like I didn't, you know, find concept art websites until I'd sort of been doing it for a couple of years.
Yeah.
And so it was a little bit of making every mistake and then trying to work it out later. But worked at a bunch of studios in Australia, worked on a couple of Spyro games, worked on some animations and background design. Spyro, right? Yeah, it was awesome. It was really cool. Worked on a Star Wars game, which I always wanted to work on, and now I know I never want to work on another Star Wars game
again. Yeah, never again.
No, I'm only joking. It's just hard when you're working on something that's that's that big a IP, and it's just everything's very
You don't mess it up, and you gotta. Yeah,
exactly. Right.
Fantastic.
But yeah, apart from that,
that's okay. So aside from that, I guess you have a huge. Yeah, I was checking out your stuff, and you've been all over the place doing all kinds of stuff. So it's super cool. So I guess for like a student or someone that is interested in doing concept arting. Would you have any like tips or advice for them? I know it's super open-ended, but like keep drawing, practice.
All the fundamental stuff, all the cliche stuff, you're always going to hear, and it's only people keep repeating it because it's very important. But you know, learning fundamentals, this is for character stuff, learning anatomy,
learning
costume as well. I think costume design would be an amazing thing to integrate into character concept art schools. Yeah,
which is actually, I never even thought about that. Like, it's huge marriage. Like, you just think about, and put some jeans on them, but like, I don't know, jack about the different types, the brands, what they look like, the cut, stuff like that.
Yeah,
like,
absolutely.
I just learned about slim cut jeans like a month ago, thanks to a TV show, so it's like...
We all watch the new episodes of Queer Eye.
We've got
the tightest jeans in the world. Now we're all rolling our shirts up just a little bit.
The French tuck or whatever it is.
The French tuck, it's the Nathan Drake tuck. So we're ahead of our time.
That's so awesome. It's super important. So
all that stuff's really important. The big one, and we're talking about it again today, this morning in the class, is understanding your pipeline, understanding whatever production you're going to be involved in. Unless you're going to be a freelancer, you know, which is all fine, or an illustrator is all fine as well. And I know there's a lot of crossover there, but if you're going to work in computer games, understand the pipeline of the projects that you're interested in.
Exactly.
So, you know, where does concept start and finish? You know, what does that mean if you draw this? What does it mean for your technical riggers, for your character artists, for the animations?
It's not just about you think about the bigger picture, basically.
Yeah, so. the art and concept art, as far as I'm concerned, the art is very soft.
Yeah.
You know, you have to learn all those artistic fundamentals to be able to do the job in the first place. But once you're in the middle of a project, you're a spoke on a wheel, and it's about the project.
Yep.
It's not about you having a nice art station website, or, you know, there's not going to be an exhibition.
Yeah, exactly. So
I'm just going to take a guess and say that none of this stuff is ever going to end up in, you know, the Museum d'Orsay or the Louvre.
Yeah,
or whatever.
Yeah, exactly.
It's about making The Last of Us Part Two as awesome as it possibly can be.
Yeah.
And if you draw a couple of nice pictures in the meantime, that's bravo as well. But
no, that's all. I mean, that's a great mentality to have. I mean, a lot of people I see is they're in it for themselves. So like for this, like you're making a game that hundreds of thousands of people are going to enjoy, so you want to make sure it's the best thing, you know, ever. Hopefully hundreds of thousands. I don't know, it might be over inflating, but I want to play it personally, so I'm excited. I'll be like, hey, I know that guy. He's dead on the floor. That's going to be cool. So
yeah, you're going to watch the trailer.
Yeah, I will now.
Terrible acting.
Hey, I thought it was pretty good, so. But I got to go ahead and wrap it up, though. I wish I could talk about this with you for hours. This is crazy. But thank you so much for speaking with us. And this will be online later. And this is Industry Giants of 2018. And I'm super excited to do the next interview. Thank you again, Richard Lyons.
Cheers, mate.
Cheers.
No worries.
Thank you so much.